Solo squads is the most casual yet sweaty thing to do in Fortnite. Like, you're playing a casual game mode, right? In a very sweaty way. It's Fortnite's biggest paradox, but you guys seem to love it so much, and you've been asking me nonstop to cover the top strategies to dominate solo squads. Since Chapter 2 is out, I guess now is a better time than ever to do it. You know, we've got a whole new loot pool, additional mechanics, and so much more that really affect the solo squad's experience. What's going on, guys? It's the Motivation Guy. That's right, your friend, the one and only Keith Allen. Make sure to connect with me on my Instagram because I want to inspire you guys to not only be great in this game, but also in life. If you're going through any adversity, you know, before we start the video, this is just food for thought. If you're going through any negativity from your family, from your friends, from playing this game even, from school, from your job, whatever it is, turn your pain into fuel that's going to drive you to greatness. You're great. But before we get into it, a lot of you guys are asking for a creator code. So here it is. Be sure to use code PROGUIDES in the item shop to support your friendly Fortnite team. Also, if you guys are interested in getting better at Fortnite, then you gotta click the link below to go to ProGuides.com, where you can play with the best players in the world just by clicking a button. Sign up for our membership at ProGuides, and you're gonna get a ton of incredible content from the best pro players like Benji and Mongrel. So if you guys wanna compete in Fortnite, you gotta check out ProGuides.com, and also be sure to drop a like on this video to show your support and love, because you know we strive to bring you guys the best content available. All right, guys, with that being said, I want you to sit back, relax, and get my favorite candy. What is it? It's that Bunch of Crunch. And let's get this going. All right, so first things first, it's super important that we talk about why solo squads needs a dedicated video. We need to break it down, the difference between professional games and casual games. Yeah, you know what I mean? Like pro scrims where the end games are stacked versus casual games where you're going to be hard pressed to find more than a handful of people past the fourth zone. Okay, so this is my point. To point out the obvious, I'm just trying to get your frame of reference and expectations when you get into a solo squad game to be in the right place. Okay, so let me give you an example. For a pro game, you're going to go against one really good player, right? Well, in a squad scrim, you're going to be going against a bunch of bad players at the same time. Let me ask you this question. It's like that one would you rather question. Would you rather fight one UFC fighter or like 100 kindergartners at the same time? I'm going to give you a second to answer that. Okay, so you probably chose what I would choose, right? That's the UFC fighter, because you've seen 100 kindergartners, right? They're scary. It's like being in the jungle. Okay, but you get what I'm saying. Squad scrims isn't about going against difficult opponents. It's really about managing a bunch of bad players at once and not taking too much damage. And that part about not taking too much damage, that's the part where I really want you to focus on, because that's the part when everyone fails when it comes to solo squads. I assume if you're watching this video, or better yet, if you have a pro pass, link in the description, we aren't talking about your ability to beat just one opponent. Alright, so let's face it, you're probably going to be the best player in your lobby. If you were playing a solo match, it should be an easy win. But where solo squads gets tricky is that you have four people in a squad to keep an eye on when you fight them. Just one person getting a sneaky rocket in or a big pump shot from the side is a death sentence for you. To tie it back to the main point, alright, this is the main point. You never have to think like this when playing in a scrim match. You also have teammates in those competitive game modes, and you're never going to get that aggressive on your own. Plus, people who do scrims are going to be a lot better than the average player, so I would definitely not recommend playing solo squads in a scrim match. Like, for real. I think if you put like Booga in a solo squad scrim match, he wouldn't even be able to play well. It's just too hard to do. So, you know, keep your solo squad matches to the casual game modes if you really want to pub stomp. All right, my friends, now that we got that out of the way, we need to address the elephant in the room. You know, why do they say elephant in the room? Have you ever thought about that? How come they don't say the dog in the room or the lion in the room? You know, there's just too many explosive items in the current loot rotation. I mean, yeah, there's only two items, grenades and RPGs. But have you seen the spawn rates on those things? Holy moly. They spawn so much that practically everyone on your squad is going to get one to play. You obviously can still win every match, especially if you're watching pro guides. But yeah, you know, you're always going to come across either an RPG or a stack of nades. And I'm not saying that you specifically should be carrying an RPG. Don't worry, we will talk about that later. But what I am saying is that if they are literally everywhere, your bot opponents are definitely going to try to use those explosive items to stop you almost every single fight. They might not be really good with utilizing explosives to the fullest extent, but they are so dang on annoying to fight against in a solo squads match. Especially if you're going against a whole team of RPG warriors. Yeah, good luck, buddy. You're in for a fun ride. Fun and annoying. This is why we have to adapt our playstyles from the ground up and not die in Chapter 2, man. Pre-Chapter 2, when explosives were extremely rare to come by, this may not apply as much, but now more than ever, you should always be listening up, yo. Always. First off, we're going to talk about why overbuilding is a must-do for solo squads. This has generally been a solid strategy since solo squads has been conceived, but now it's a must-do if you ever want to see consistent kills in this game mode. Overbuilding, my friends, is simply spamming more builds to cover yourself better. When you have up to four people spamming you at the same time, it's pretty much impossible to stand on only one or two support pieces. You're just going to get shot out all the time, and it's going to take a huge amount of damage in the process. But now you've got to add all those explosives to the mix, man. And now, if you're not building entirely fortified structures over your opponent, tough luck, buddy, because your butt is about to fall to the ground. I mean, you're going to be sounding like, you know what I mean? And eventually, you're going to be back into the lobby. I know that this meta is a bit frustrating. I get it. For solo squads, yes, but we're going to get through it together, all right? You got to trust me. Trust your friend, the one and only Keith Allen. I'm here. You know what I mean? And this really isn't that drastic of a change, guys. It really isn't. I know a lot of you guys do scrims pretty often and are constantly reminded to save mats because you're going to need it for endgame. But remember, my friends, what did I say earlier? There is no endgame to worry about because you're going to be wiping them all out by fifth zone tops. Also, if you can kill an entire squad in the mid game, chances are at least one of those goblins were hoarding a bunch of materials, which should give you all the room in the world to continue using builds rather generously. And once you get yourself set with the mindset that building more is fine, then we can talk about making quicker decisions and generally running around more. I'm gonna be real with you guys, not having any mobility items in this current loot pool, whoa. Man, it really makes solo squatting much more difficult. I can't seem to get out of any sticky situation whenever I want to anymore. Why? Because of what I just said. In the past, you know, you could just use your shockwaves and launch pads to get out of any trouble, right? That's just not the case anymore. What we gotta do is we have to adapt. We really need to stop putting ourselves in the sticky situations to begin with, to be real. Now, you know, when you think of getting yourself into a dicey spot, you know, you can realize that a lot of the time it's due to you either taking a long time with the fight or just overcommitting something that you didn't realistically think you could handle. Have you ever intentionally went out of zone to chase down a squad, knowing full well that your 8 launch pads are gonna get you out no matter what? Well, I'm sorry about that, but you don't get that luxury anymore. Instead, you're gonna have to be moving to zones quicker and not take those fights anymore. That in the current meta makes zero sense to take. Being a fast mover doesn't just apply to rotating with the zones. This applies to everything from finishing a fight quickly to looting the eliminated player loot. Doing all of these things quicker is going to add to help you fight against the lack of mobility on a map that I have to say feels bigger than the old map. Basically, you're not getting the same luxury of time in Chapter 2 if you want to successfully solo squad. Move fast and make smart decisions because you have no safety net. All right, ladies and gentlemen, let's move past the overall strategy and talk a little more about your inventory. What you should be carrying to have the easiest solo squatting experience. Well, let's break it down into a few categories. First, the most important item in your inventory. Well, you already know this. The shotgun, obviously. With Chapter 2 seeing a very rarity of tactical and pump shotguns in the game, you know, you really do have to have a good variety of choices here. The problem is that if you're used to the pump, it's going to be much harder to solo squat with the lower rarities. The common, uncommon, and rare pumps do 70, 80, and 90 damage respectively. A full headshot won't even one pump. You need to carry a tactical shotgun unless you find the purple or gold pump. They are way more consistent and hold more bullets to take out more opponents before having to reload. Unless you think you can hit a headshot with every pump shot, controller players, then I highly recommend going with the TAC. Your inventory is going to have a shotgun, rifle, potentially an SMG, and definitely at minimum one healing item. You really only have one extra inventory slot that can be used for either another healing item or explosive. So let me explain why I would personally go for the extra healing items over explosive weapons. Alright, so first off, people have gotten a lot better at building when they see an RPG or a grenade. So you probably won't get many kills at all from the explosives. On the off chance that you do end up getting a kill with an explosive, chances are that the opponent was so bad that you could have just killed him with the rifle. Alright, so take a look at Kanata playing in the Code Red tournament with Tfue. Basically, solo squatting right here. He kills an absolute bot using an RPG, but the only guys he's really able to kill using the RPG is someone that he could have just shot down with a regular gun. Kinda makes owning explosives a bit pointless, don't you think? Look, I'm just saying that if you got to consistently fight four people at a time, you're not going to come out completely undamaged, right? The more inventory slots you reserve for a healing item reduces the RNG associated with running out of healing items in the long term. Nobody likes dying because they are stuck at 75 HP and no shields from not carrying the extra heals. So, let's go over everything one more time. Your mindset needs to separate pro scrims and solo squads because they need different skill sets. Your opponents are going to most likely have more explosive items compared to last season, so please be prepared to overbuild as a solid counter. No point in dying with extra mats in your inventory that you could have used to save yourself. With the general lack of mobility, guys, there is exactly zero room for error when deciding what fights to take and how early to rotate. Get moving early, guys, or you're not going to have a fun time playing solo squads in Chapter 2. Finally, you're going to generally want to use the Tac Shotgun over Pump, and make sure to stack more heals in your inventory over anything else. Once again, this is the Motivation Guy. That's right, the one and only Keith Allen. Make sure to follow me as soon as you can on my Instagram, because I'm posting up vids to help inspire you to not only be great in this game, but also in life. So, we really hope you enjoyed this today. Comment down below what you thought and what you'd like to see next. We strive to bring you the best daily content, so do us a favor by liking this video. Subscribe to the channel and show ProGuys.com some love for bringing you this video. Thanks for watching once again. We'll see you next time.